You guys ready? How many enjoyed Lynn Hiles? Wasn't that good? Praise God. You know what I know, and I'll go ahead and start that. What I know too, and I tell people this a lot, I've seen people come, for example, with him and other New Covenant ministers, and they think, man, that guy's a great preacher. And yeah, he is a great preacher and teacher. Nothing diminished from that. But what they don't know is it's not the fact that he's a great preacher that's the great thing. It's what he's preaching that's great. Can you hear that? And see, and that's with any of us. It's what we're preaching. You know, to try to articulate the goodness of God, I'm sitting down there, and things are just exploding on the inside of me about what Christ has done. And I'm going to try to articulate some of that today. So I believe that the Lord wants you encouraged to know where you're already at. And where you're already at, if you're a believer, if you're born again, I stress that. And where you're at is in Christ, the promised land. Remember Brother Hiles talked about that. You are there. And I was this morning, the Lord started saying all kinds of things to me. And when do you prepare your messages? All the time. It's a constant. There's always stuff coming on my hand. I was like, okay, this is a general way I think I'm going, Lord, and it could go different. Just ask Bob. He's anointed to follow me. If I preach it, Bob's got to be with me or somebody that can keep up, because I don't always know where I'm going, but I know it's going to be about Jesus and what he did. Amen? Everything in the Bible is about what Christ did and what he did for you. And this is where people struggle, but he really did it as you, because when you identify with what he did, I mean, when he was crucified, you were crucified. For example, Paul said in Galatians 2:20, I am, that's not a good translation, crucified, Old King James. It's literally, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet it's not I, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Boop. Next verse, I do not frustrate or lay aside the grace of God. For if righteousness comes by my own merit, then Christ died for nothing or in vain. See, and so this morning I was meditating, and the Lord started talking to me, and it's been on my heart for started like yesterday and today. It's what I call the someday illusion. What do you mean by the someday illusion? Well, let me give you an example, and I want to show you. This message is the many faces of mixture part two, and I'm going to give you an example of mixture, the someday illusion. What is the someday? That someday, are you ready for this? Someday I'm going to be happy. Someday when I get that bill paid off, then I'll be happy. Someday if I'm single, when I get married, I'll be happy. Someday when this happens, I'll be happy. Someday when I retire, I'll be happy. Someday. It's always someday. It's never today. Amen? I call it the someday illusion. Now I'm going to bring it into our lives right here. Even finished work, gospel, grace, whatever you want to call it, someday when I get enough information about what Jesus did, I'm going to experience it. The many faces of mixture. See how subtle that is? Someday when I just pray a little more, when I just can quote a few more verses, when I can just, you know, read my Bible. See, someday's today. Now let me say something. What you need to hear is where you already are in Christ. Now watch this. Do you need to hear? Absolutely. But it isn't how many New Covenant sermons you hear that causes it to be given to you. You've already got it. You know, it's like having an inheritance in the bank. Whether you ever make a withdrawal or not, you still got it. And I love what Michael said this morning. I wrote it down. It blessed me. He said, for example, I'm going to say healing. You know you've already, I'm not even going to say healing, because healing means you're sick. I'm going to say you've already got health. Now, I'm all for healing, don't get me wrong, and I'm not into this New Age denial stuff either, because that's denial. But you've already got health. And he shared an example this morning. He said, like he's running around, you know, cough medicine. Where's the cough medicine? Well, I got to go to Walmart or wherever and get some cough medicine, and the whole time it's in the cupboard. Somebody just needs to open the cupboard and unveil what's already there. And see, and that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to unveil what's already there. It's amazing. I'm going to spend a little time on the someday illusion, because this is a manifestation of mixture, of not understanding. Listen, I'm not going to postpone my happiness and my joy. I'm not waiting till we knock that back wall out to be happy, if we do. It doesn't matter. Are you hearing me? You know, it's so awesome to be free. And the more I see what he did, the freer I am. Free from stuff like what other people think. Glory to God. Because you know what? The more you try to please people, anybody ever experienced this? The more you try to explain yourself, you know what the Lord said? I'm your attorney. Just sit back and watch what I do. It's so simple. But the someday illusion always says, well, you know, someday when this gets right. Someday when Jen starts treating me right. Anybody give me a ride home? Yeah, Jen goes, best of luck with that. You know, but see, that's what it is. And here again, we need to hear more about what Christ has done. But it's so subtle where you can get, someday when I hear another good gospel grace message, someday I'm going to begin to walk in what God says I already have. You need to understand, let me say it to you this way. Now faith, you already have faith. And I'm going to say it to you this way, and you got to hear this. I don't need faith to receive this Bible. It's already mine. I don't need faith to receive it. I already got it. Oh, somebody hear this. See, we've even made faith a work. When the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. You know what he's saying? Without faith in what Jesus did, you'll never please him in your own strength. You can never do it. That's what he's saying. See, I'm going to say some things here that I want to say, that I believe he wants me to say. First of all, let me just start with the verses. I told you, Bob, when I gave you the verses, I said this might be close. Revelation chapter 3, we've been talking about this. The church of Laodicea, remember that? I'm not going to do the whole thing, okay, for the sake of time. But look at verses 18 and 19. Watch this. Revelation chapter 3, verses 18 and 19. And this is after he talked about lukewarmness. And we talked about lukewarm isn't, you know, doing good and not doing. It's not that at all. Lukewarm means a mixture of law and grace. I haven't got time to go back into all that. You know, what makes water lukewarm is you got some hot and some cold. And you put them together and it's lukewarm. Okay? Amen? Like Jen, when she takes a bath, I mean, you could boil lobster in there, man. I mean, it's like, wow. I don't know how she does it. And it's like, you know, I think I'm tough, and then there ain't no way I'm getting in that. Anyhow, but anyhow, so he says, he tells them to repent. He tells them to change their mind, right? That's what repentance is. It's on the list. Repentance is not, it's not crying at an altar. A lot of people cry at an altar, and they get up, and they're the exact same. Repent means to change your mind. Metanoia. And let me say this about in Romans chapter 2, verse 4, where it says the goodness of God leads men to repent or to change their mind. See, when you see that God's not the angry God you see in the Old Testament, he is the same. He doesn't change. But the way he deals with you and I because of what Jesus did at the cross is completely different. And the way he deals with the world who's not born again is completely different. God is not judging the world. He's already judged the world, but they need to receive it. Amen? Can you hear that? Can anybody hear that? Now, I don't believe everybody's saved. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying he died for everybody's sin, and if they receive it, it's a done deal. Okay? So repentance means to change your mind. And in Romans 2:4, where it says it's the goodness of God, not the badness of judgment. God has no bad. It's not God's judgment that leads men to repentance. We could go into Romans 1 about the wrath of God's been revealed, all that kind of stuff. But it's the goodness of God that will lead you to change your mind. Amen? We're going to talk about this today, and I'm going to talk about some questions that people have. You know, me and Lynn Hiles, we were talking about this, and he says the same thing I say. I believe in living right, but it's how you get there that's completely different. You can't get to being right in your own strength. Amen? Let me give you an example. The Lord gave me this morning. Say a husband and wife. I use that example a lot. I pay for it when I get home, but I'm kidding. But say I'm worked up about something. And Jen comes to me and she says, Chris, you need to knock off acting like that. Is that true? Absolutely. Do I need to knock it off? Absolutely. But you know what she's done by saying it that way? She's put it all back on why. And so here's what I do. I try to change my behavior. It's called behavior modification. And it may work temporarily or on the outside work, but it doesn't change my heart. But now what if in the same situation, she came to me and she said, Chris, that is not who you are. Hear the difference? Is she dealing with the behavior? Yes or no? Yes. But the way she's dealing with it is reminding me, you're a master, Chris. You don't have to go hog wild and with, you know, your emotions and all that. Some of you are hearing. No, many of you are not. And the husbands are afraid. No, okay. But that's not who I am. And by her reminding me that that's not who I am, that hey, you're a master. Let me say this to you. Do you know the only way you can be offended is if you allow someone to offend you? I used to think, well, they shouldn't do that. That's probably true, but that has nothing to do with it. Nobody can offend you without your cooperation. Cooperation. Nobody can offend you without your consent. Did you know that? You know, I don't have to be offended. You know why? That's not who I am. Jesus never reacted. He was always in control. And through him, so are you. Hallelujah. See, oh, I got to say some things. Are you ready? I got to do this. Oh, there's so many things. I can already see. I'm not going to cover near all this. I'm going to read to you from the Message Bible. Because we're talking about seeing. Well, let me finish those verses, and then we'll go. I'm going to read something from the Message Bible. I counsel you to buy me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, now, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. This is what I'm after, that you may see. All these things he says to do as a believer you have. But here's what I'm after. You need to see what you have. See, and I asked the Lord, I said, well, then what is growth? What is growth? Here's the definition he gave me of growth. I wrote it down. Growth for a Christian is understanding where you already are in Christ. The more you understand where you already are, the more it will manifest in your life through the fruit of the Spirit. Well, I hope I get to the works of the flesh today. Pray that I do. Because I want to show you that. I'm telling you what, this will absolutely set you so free. You start, listen, if you're acting contrary to the way you are in Christ, I'm just here to tell you that's not who you are. People get worked up about, I'm going to say it, homosexuality. You know what I feel for those people? Compassion. And what's the difference between that and gossip? Ooh, we categorize. It's okay to gossip. I'm just telling you, it all misses the mark. And it's all because people haven't received his ability. When I say a sharp word to my wife, which I never do, I just lied, because that's not who I am. That's not who I am either. I immediately know it. Because that's not who I am. Amen? That's not who I am. He made me a master. I've talked to you many times about Ephesians 4:28. Don't go there, but where it says, let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, that he may have to give to him that needs. Now listen to this. If somebody's stealing, he's saying, don't do that anymore. You know what he's saying? He's not saying, you better not do that or God's going to be mad at you. He's saying, you're a master. This isn't who you are. Knock it off. I love it. You're empowered. But see, that's what we need to see. You're already in a place. Denny said that during the worship. You're already in a place. It's called Christ. Lynn said it when he was here. The promised land's not a piece of real estate in the Middle East or anywhere else for that matter. The promised land is a person named Jesus. And if you're born again, you're in him and he's in you, in the person of the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, we don't realize what we have or who we have or who has us. However you want to say it, it's the same thing. It's awesome. And the more you realize, I find it amazing how I can be happy in the midst of psychoness sometimes. People say, I'm telling you, you got a pastor. You mean people say things and all this and that and this and oh, blah, 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 blah. I find the more you ignore some things, you can't ignore everything. They'll go away. Just spend time. I mean, I can't control anything, but that's freedom. I don't have to. He don't want me to. Hallelujah. Try, you know, when you say so many things, but well, what about this and what about that? And people, listen, you can't say everything in one message. You do the best you can, you follow the lead, but those that are hearing by the Spirit will hear. Now watch this in Revelation, Romans chapter 3, or 5, I'm sorry. I just want to read it from the Message Bible. Lynn, I think, said some of this too, but I want you to see this because I'm after something here. Here it is in a nutshell. It's verses 18 and 19, Romans chapter 5 from the Message Bible. Here it is in a nutshell. Just as one person did it wrong and got us all into this trouble with sin and death, that one person was Adam. That one person was Adam. He did it wrong, and all the mess you see is because of Adam. I heard one guy say one time when people stand in heaven and they cross over, whatever you want to call it, and they're standing there, and that they'll say, well, who's over there? Well, that's Adam, all that security. Because everybody's going to be after him. No, I'm kidding. Watch this. So he got it wrong. He got us all into trouble with sin and death. Another person did it right and got us out of it. That would be Jesus. The Bible calls him the last Adam in 1 Corinthians 15. He did it right and got us out of trouble. Now, we love that part, that he got us out of trouble, right? That we're free. But watch this. It gets gooder. Watch this. But more than just getting us out of trouble, he got us into life. See, a lot of people, I love what Lynn said. It really hammered me this week, past weekend. He said something so good. He said most of what people are calling freedom is just rebellion against the law. Are you hearing that? They're rebelling against all the rules they've been under. I liken it to the dog that you have in the house that never gets out. You ever had one of those? You open the door and that dog's... and all the neighborhood's chasing it. The owners are praying that a car hits it. You know all that, under their breath. All that kind of stuff. You know what I'm saying? But it's just rebellion. It's not that they hate their master. It's just that they're just, man, they've never tasted this freedom. But see, here's what maturity is. For a believer, you start seeing that God got me into a life. Now, I'm going to say something here, and some religious people will fall off their chair. Somebody catch them. But I'm just going to say it because you need to hear it. If I drank a glass of wine, which I don't think there's anything wrong with that, I know some people choke on that. I'm not out here advocating wine drinking. That's not what I'm saying. Please don't hear that. I don't care for it. But if I did, I couldn't get drunk if I wanted to. Oh, somebody hear this. It's not who I am. Oh, he's drinking wine. I knew it, Myrtle. Let's go. I'm not drinking wine. Are you hearing me? It's so powerful. The Bible says, drink no longer water, but drink a little wine for thy stomach's sake and then often infirmities. I heard one person say, you're not drinking that for your stomach. When the Bible says, when he came eating and drinking, it wasn't talking about bottled water. I'll let you meditate on that. What had a cow with it? Religion. See, I love this, man. So often we take things that are socially acceptable with our culture and we mix a few verses with it and we call that the gospel. Lynn told me something else I thought was really good. Do you know in some of those countries, they look at us as sinners because our women shave their armpits. I'm serious. They think that's like an abomination. But they go down after the service and everybody's got a beer. And we're like, huh? Oh, some of you need set free. You are empowered. You're not set free to sin. You're set free from sin. Sin is nothing anymore. It's a non-issue. A no thing, as somebody said. It's nothing. It's been defeated completely. But see, I used to look at people. Here's what religion does. It makes you judgmental and self-righteous. You know, instead of loving people, you're all concerned about whether they smoke or not. I don't think you should smoke. It's bad for you. I don't care if you do. Won't send you to hell. Make you smell like you've been there. I just like saying that. But see, here's what we do. And here's what people are doing. All of a sudden, they get free, you know, from religion. And like Lynn was talking about, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And you know, we get this guy that was real bad dude. We clean him up and we make him religious. And then the other guy who was real religious gets free and he swings over here and he's a coke addict. It's the same tree. We don't swing from one bondage to another. We're in life, man. Now, here's what I'm after. More than just getting us out of trouble, he got us into a life. More than just getting us out of trouble, which he did do that, he got us into life. And that trouble he's talking about was the law that God gave, which was good and holy, Romans 7:12, but which condemned man because he could never measure up. Are you hearing? It condemned you and I because we could never measure up to it. So Jesus came, the Son of God, as the Son of Man, fully God, fully man, and fulfilled everything. He fulfilled the law that needed to be fulfilled that you and I couldn't fulfill, and then he turns around and gives it to us. Whew, good deal. And he gives it to us. So what this does is it empowers us. It empowers me to live right. He got me into a life. He did not just get me out of trouble. He did that, but he got me into a life, and now I'm empowered to do right things. Now it's who I am. The Bible says in, I believe it's Titus chapter 2, verse 14. Let's see if that's it. Hopefully it is. It's a good verse. And if not, I know Ephesians 2:10 is really good too. Titus chapter 2, verse 14. Yes, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, a unique people, a different people, a set apart people, zealous of good works. Zealous of good works. Ephesians 2:10 says, we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. In other words, here it is. Like these signs say, these banners, this is who you are. This is who you are. Praise God. Let me finish this, and then I'm going to say some other things. Is that okay? You still love me? See, I have to say this. We have made rules rather than relationship. And the rules is what's killing people. You'll see that here in a minute. Watch this. Continuing in the Message Bible, I love this. He got us into life. One man said no to God and put many people in the wrong. One man said yes to God and put many in the right. Referring to Adam, the first Adam, Christ, the last Adam. All that passing of laws against sin did was produce more lawbreakers. All the passing of laws does is produce more lawbreakers. The only difference now is people hide it. Somebody said, there was a guy that came in this conference we was at, and he was drunk. I didn't see it, but they told me about it. And he would come in, he goes, you know what he said? Watch this. He said, and he was apologizing to, sitting in the back, apologizing. And he said, you know, I just like being here. Would to God they'd say that here. I just like being here. I just like being here because you guys love me, man. It isn't. See, here's the beautiful thing. You don't have to change anybody. You can anyhow. Sorry to bust your bubble. You can put laws on people and try to get them to act right, and you can take that poodle and dress it up, or that pig and dress it up like a poodle and take it to the dog show, but I guarantee you, it's probably not going to walk very good. And as soon as it gets back to the mire, it's going to go right back in. See, all the passing of laws does is produce more lawbreakers. Hallelujah. See, here's what I'm after. Listen to this. If you never come out from under the law, you'll never get into the life that you have. Oh boy, I got a camp there. If you never come out from under a law mentality, you'll never experience the life that you already have in Christ. I'm going to keep saying that. You got to get that. That point right there is amazing. So this is why the adversary, the Bible says the law strengthens sin. It revives sin. You want to have a revival of sin? Just preach the Ten Commandments. Right? Just preach, thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not do this. Thou shalt not do that. You want to have a revival of sin? I heard stories from individuals that I met this past week, and one prominent ministry, they said, a very judgmental, self-righteous ministry, they said the sexual sin among those leaders is unprecedented. But it's covered up. All that passing of laws does is make more lawbreakers. And let me tell you this, they say, well, they're, you know, well, look at this. They come to church and they smell like alcohol. Praise God, it's coming out in the open. Now the person's going to, you know, wow, they got a chance to get set free. I tell people this, you want to stay in bondage to sin, just receive condemnation. You'll keep going around the mountain and never get free. When you realize that God doesn't condemn you because that all fell on Jesus at the cross, you're empowered now to come out. Oh, glory. Oh, glory. All that passing of laws did was produce more lawbreakers. Let me go here. But sin didn't and doesn't have a chance in competition with the aggressive forgiveness we call grace. See, you know why we have put laws on people? Because we don't really believe that grace is more powerful. That's why. Amen. Nobody amen there. Thanks, Jen. I love you, honey. It has no chance. See, the reason people, when people say this, and they will say stuff like, well, you're just light on sin. I can look right back. I'm not going to compromise. Say, you're light on the cross. You're light on what Jesus did. I don't get hung up. I don't categorize sin. In fact, I'm going to come back here. I'm going there anyhow. Galatians 5, watch this. Verse 19, this is the works of the flesh. Now, I'm not going to go through all of them because that's not the point. But I want you to understand that in Galatians 5:19, it calls them the works. Everybody say works of the flesh. And when you get to Galatians 5:22, it refers to the fruit of the Spirit. One is works, other is fruit. You know what the flesh is here? It's all of my self-effort. I may not do something externally, which is good. It could be good for my life, right? But in my heart, this is why I say this a lot. You've heard me say this before. It's one thing when you don't sin because you're not supposed to. It's another thing when you don't want to. B is better. See, but it's all contingent upon you realizing who you are. See, when I've been camping on the mixture of thinking you've got to get somewhere, that someday when I get enough information about the finished work, then I'm not going to blow up all the time whenever somebody says something to me. Then I'm not going to gossip like I used to. Someday when I get to that place, you're already at that place. It's important that you hear that. But you don't need more information to get to that place. You don't need more sermons, more conferences. You don't need more to get to any place you already are. How foolish would it be for me to try to labor to be in this room? I'm already in it. We would call 1-800-PADDED-TRUCK. Right? But people do that all the time. And the church gets up and we tell people, you're not who he says you are. This is why it's difficult to explain things. I'm going to give you an example. It's difficult sometimes to explain things like, it's good to have a devotional with the Lord. Do you know that? Well, he never leaves me nor forsakes me. True. Pray without ceasing. I'm always in communion with God. That's all good and great. But you know it's good to have a devotional time with the Lord. Mark 1:35. Jesus got up a great while before day and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. Now, I'm not talking about this. He communed with his Father. He had a relationship. But you know, in all of my years, through the mixture, legalistic years, and even through the grace years, I've never been able to say, well, at such and such a time, I'm going to seek God. Maybe you can. I can. God doesn't want it that way. It's a relationship. But just this past, sometimes longer, sometimes shorter. I study all the time. But you know, there's a time, even as a preacher, that I need to study just to commune with my Father, not for a message. But he showed me something so powerful. And I'm just going to, are we adults here, right, most? I don't mean this mean, but you know, my wife and I, we're intimate sometimes, physically, communicatively, if that's a word it is now, and we communicate, but it's just between husband and wife, right? Do you know, I'm not trying to be gross, but you'll understand this. Her and I are intimate, but there's times when you're intimate, you're just with each other. Are you hearing me? You cut off all distractions. You can do the same activity, and if somebody's watching, it's not intimate. And I ain't doing it. And neither is she. Because that freaks me out. And that's what he said. He said, it's not a matter of having to do anything. And you find, like, I told one, I said, man, I slept in today. It was 6:45. That's like sleeping in anymore. I just get up. I guess driving bus did that to me. I don't know what happened. But it's just, I never was, he just gets me. It doesn't have to be in the morning. It can be at night. It's not about what time of day it is. But you will find out, this is what we're after. I can tell you that right now. If you never come out of the law and bondage, you'll never get into the life that you already have. And that's the danger of the law. The Bible says the law, Galatians 3:23, shuts up faith in what Christ did. In other words, let me say it another way. Faith doesn't operate. Christ becomes of no effect unto you, according to Galatians 5:4. He's talking to believers. Do you know, isn't it crazy to think that as a believer, Christ could be of no effect? What he did, in other words, he purchased peace and joy and healing and all those types of things, but I can walk like he never did that. In other words, he's of no effect in my life. You know why? Because I'm justified by trusting in my own merit instead of what he did. And here it is again, the subtlety of the mixture of thinking you've got to get somewhere to be something you already are. You need to keep hearing about it. I tell people all the time, you need to come to church, you need to hear this stuff, but not to impress God. God's not impressed with your church attendance. Thank God you come because you need to hear it. And hear it. We call it gospel surround sound. And hear it. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Well, my emotions are going nuts. That isn't who I am. Well, they said this. They offended me. Nobody can offend me without my cooperation or my consent. Nobody. The only way you can offend me is if I allow you to offend me. That's the power of the gospel. That's the power of grace. Paul said it like this in Romans 1:16. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. The gospel, the good news. It is the power of God unto deliverance, salvation, not just when you die. And to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Why the Jew first? Is he better? No, it just means that it came to him first through the God gave the law to the Jew, not to the Gentile. But now he's concluded all in unbelief so he could have mercy upon everybody. And the Jews know better than the Palestinian. Amen? I guarantee you, unless Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley got born again, I'm more of a Jew than they are. Those are the two guys in KISS, they're Jewish. Unless they got born again, I pray they do. I'm more of a Jew than they are. Because it's not about natural lineage. He is not a Jew which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he's a Jew which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, whose praise is not of men but of God, Romans 2:28 and 29. Right, Rexella? Sorry. Why did I do that? I'm sorry. Rexella. No, sorry. That's Chuck. I'm sorry. Sorry. Help me, Lord. Amen. All that passing laws against sin did was produce more lawbreakers. But sin didn't and doesn't have a chance in competition with the aggressive forgiveness we call grace. When it's sin versus grace, grace wins hands down. All sin can do is threaten us with death, and that's the end of it. Grace, because God is putting everything together again through the Messiah, invites us into life, a life that goes on and on and on and on, world without end. Now, I'm sorry, Galatians 5, watch this. Verse 19. Now, the works of the flesh are these. The works of the flesh are these. Now, let's define flesh. In the book of Galatians, Paul said it like this. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 3, he said, are you so foolish, talking to Christians? You begun in the spirit by trusting what Christ has done. Are you now made perfect in the flesh? King James. The NIV says, do you now attain your goal, which is maturity and manifestation of the fruit of the Spirit? Do you now attain your goal through human effort? That's flesh. That's what I'm after. Flesh, everybody say this, flesh is human effort in the book of Galatians. Okay, now watch this. That's why he calls it the works of the flesh. Are you hearing? The works of the flesh. In other words, the more you try, all that passing of laws did was produce more sinners or more lawbreakers. That's all it does. So the more laws you pass, if passing laws could have done it, then the church should be, man, I mean, we've had more information. We should be the most unified thing on the planet. You know, the most divided thing I've seen has been the body of Christ. Hallelujah. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest or obvious or open knowledge is what that's saying, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, ooh, bad, idolatry, witchcraft, amen, hatred. What's that doing in there? I remember these people at a church and this couple, and they wouldn't come to church because they did, their granddaughter of some other couple went there, and they were mad at them. That's called hatred. It's a work of the flesh. Isn't it amazing? It amazes me how we define big and little. It just amazes me. Some have greater consequences in the natural. And it goes on to say witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. Groups organized into factions, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, which means addicted to light moments or pleasure. Addicted to light moments or pleasure. That's what that means. Watch this. And such like of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Please leave that up there, because I want to say something about this. Now, we've made this like, well, if you do this, you're going to hell. That's not what that's saying. The word do there is praiso in Greek, I believe it is. I'm gonna do some more research on it. It's been a while. But it means practice. What he's saying is if I'm practicing these things, it's because I don't know who I am in Christ. That's what he's saying. And I'm not inheriting the kingdom, because if I was inheriting the kingdom and receiving what Christ did, it would empower me not to practice these things. Oh, somebody hear it. Somebody hear it. That's what he's saying. You know, I'm telling you guys, If doing this, one of those things one time, like envying. You know what I tell God? I love this. I'm just going to say it. If Paul White, if you're watching, you hear me. Paul White preached at the conference. And I told my friend when I got, I say, I don't pull punches with God anymore. I stopped being dishonest with God and myself. Not saying, I walked out and I told my friend Roger Legg, I said, you know, Roger, I'm jealous of him. Ooh, too honest? But you know what? I know that ain't who I am. And you know what I've discovered? When I tell God that, he already knows it anyhow. And I give him that, guess what? He takes it. All of a sudden, I'm not jealous of him. I'd rather be me than anybody else in Christ. Are you hearing? But see, we cover things up. Like you hear these, oh, bless God, Joel Osteen. He's not preaching. Oh, he's not doing this. I tell people all the time, the reason people criticize Joel Osteen is because they're jealous. I'm talking about preachers and others. That's why. Call it what it is. Now you're in a position to see clearly. But see, if I walk in jealousies and envies or any of these things, it's because I'm not inheriting or receiving the kingdom that I'm already in as a Christian. I'm going to say this, guys. He's writing this to Christians. The book of Galatians is to Christians who are mixing law and grace. And saying, Paul's saying, what are you doing? Who's bewitched you? Who's put a spell on you? That's what's going on. We make that, bless God, you're going to go to hell. That's what we do. You know, the reason people don't want Christ, it's not that Christ they're rejecting. It's all the law passing and the hypocrisy in the church. That's what they reject. Jesus is irresistible. I challenge you when you read through Jesus' earth walk, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I challenge you to see who Jesus hung out with. It offended the religious people. If he were a prophet, he would know what manner of woman this is. I have somewhat to say unto thee. And Jesus was cool about it. I don't know that I would have been that cool about it. Now I'm gonna tackle some others. We're talking about seeing. I got a little bit of time here. This is awesome. Because this is really good. There's scriptures in the Bible that I've got to see it how God's saying it. And you know, sometimes the languages will clear it up. Did you know that? Crystal clear. 1 John chapter 3, verse 7. I've been meditating on this. Watch this. These are verses. Well, if you sin, you're of the devil. Well, then we're all of the devil. Boy, one little laugh. That makes me nervous. Start the van and pull it up front. Them side doors open. Watch this. Little children, let no man deceive you. And the word deceive there is in the present tense. Let nobody be deceiving you. I got other verses around here. I'm just going to do two. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. There you go, Chris. Righteousness is right doing. No, it is. That's not what he's saying. It results in right doing called the fruit of the Spirit, but that's not what he's saying. The Greek says, he that doeth or practices righteousness, there's a definite article in the Greek, the righteousness. And the word righteousness is a noun, person, place, or thing, and it's singular. He's talking about a nature that we have in Christ. He that doeth in accordance with the righteousness. It's because he's born again. All glory. Is righteous, which is an adjective descriptive of the noun, even as he is righteous. He's talking about a nature. He's not talking about, well, you sinned, you're of the devil. Next verse. Watch this. He that committeth sin, bless God, there it is of the devil. Devil. I like what Joseph Prince says. Any resemblance is purely coincidental. That's funny. I don't care who you are. Larry the Cable Guy says that. Okay. He that committeth sin, watch this, is of the devil. This is powerful. He that committeth, make sure I got it right. I knew that. He that committeth the, definite article in the Greek, which is referring sin, singular noun. He's talking about a nature. He's not talking about stubbing your toe and cussing. He's talking about a nature. He that committeth the sin, watch this, is of. Everybody say of. Now say ek. That's the Greek word there, which means it's a preposition. It means out of. It's referring to a nature. It's because the person that lives and practices from that nature of rebellion against what God has done, it's because he's out of the devil. He's not born again. That's what he's saying. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might, watch this, destroy the works of the devil. That's a power. Might destroy in the Greek is luo. Luo means to unloose or unlatch. I think it's John 1:27 where John the Baptist said about Jesus, I'm not worthy to unlatch his sandal. Same Greek word. It's used when in Mark 11 when he tells him, hey, go get the colt, Jesus said, and untie him. It's untie or unloose or unlatch. Jesus has unlatched us from the works of the devil. There's other verses around there that we will probably cover sometime. But a person who commits the sin, it's because his nature's out of the devil. He's not born again. Oh, glory. Doesn't that kind of set you free? Doesn't that set you free? Should I do 1 John 1:9? You want to do 1 John 1:9? Because that's a big debate. Oh, it's a big debate. Bring it on, my wife says. I like that. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, this is a big debate. You know that. Oh, God bless God. You got to confess your sins. Let me just say this up front. Let me say one thing up front. Paul never used this that I can find anywhere in Paul's writings, what John says here. And if you have to confess every sin to get it forgiven, what if you miss one? What if you miss one? Word, thought, or deed, I guarantee you're going to miss one. Now, to me, I know the whole Gnostic thing. I get it. That this was written to the Gnostics, and the Gnostics said sin was a myth, and I believe that because of the way it starts off. But it's so simple when you just read it in context. Back up two verses to verse 7. Watch this. Verse 7. Watch this. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. You know what? When you're walking in the light, it's just automatic. You have fellowship. The understanding of what Christ has done, you have fellowship one with another. You know that the great danger I see in the body of Christ, I've been talking to some of my friends, they're talking about, you know, everybody, there's so much separation. Sometimes we get a call in our life and everybody wants to go out and start a church. Not that if that, but you know, what if we work together and touch the world? Some of you hear that. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another and the blood of Jesus Christ. There's a constant cleansing, cleanses us from all sin. Next verse. But if we say that we have no sin, no, back up to verse 5, because I want to run this up further. This is the message that we heard from the beginning and declare to you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Next verse. If we say, this is what I'm after. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Now, this is setting you up for 1 John 1:9. If I'm saying I'm walking, look at this. If I say, man, I'm fellowshipping with him, but I'm walking in darkness. What is darkness? Furthest away from the light, right? The veil on your heart causes you to walk in darkness. What is the veil? It's something good and holy called the law. Because it veils you from who you are in Christ. And it causes you to walk in darkness. Proverbs says you stumble. You don't know what you stumble over. If we say that we have fellowship, if I say I'm fellowshipping with him, but my life is contradicting that fellowship, God says I'm a liar. That's what he's saying. See, grace, when it comes to grace and sin, grace wins hands down. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Next verse. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another and the blood of Jesus Christ. There's a constant cleansing of his blood. You are cleansed. I'm not going to camp there. Next verse. If we say that we have no sin, remember verse 6? If I say that walking contrary to that is not missing the mark, see, here again, historically, the Gnostics taught that sin was a myth. And that's what John is dealing with here. They taught sin was a myth. They basically taught Jesus was a myth. That's why when you get into chapter 2, he says, my little children. And some people say, well, there's no part of the Bible that's written to the world. I beg to differ, because if you read James chapter 4, he says, cleanse your hands, you sinners. Amen? I don't know. Just thought I'd throw that at you. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Next verse. If we confess that this walking in darkness and having hatred for one another is not God's, it's not who I am. I'm paraphrasing so you get it. He's faithful and just. And I do believe this is written in Gnostics. See, he's already forgiven you of every sin, past, present, and future. Every one. But if I'm walking contrary to that and saying, I'm denying who I am in Christ. Well, I think it's simple when you look at the context. But there's the big debate, you know, the Gnostic. All that stuff goes on. But I just say real simple. If you have to confess every sin, then you better hope you don't miss any. But see, what that does is we become sin conscious instead of righteousness conscious. One more verse I'm going to close with. Ready? Proverbs chapter 20, verse 13. I got 45 minutes, then I'll be done. It's a joke. Proverbs 20, 13. Watch this. Love not sleep. All right, that means nobody goes to bed tonight. No. It's not talking about a good night's rest, okay? I was talking this week, and I say the joke. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 27 and 28, it says, be angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down in your wrath. Neither give place to the devil. He's talking about never stop being angry at evil, basically. He's not talking about husbands and wives. You have an argument, get it patched up before you go to bed. And it's good that you do that, don't get me wrong. That's not what he's talking about. And I was telling the joke. I said, yeah, you know the couple. They said, we never go to bed mad. We haven't been to bed in 13 years. But well, he's not talking about a good night's sleep. Love not sleep. The Bible says, and I'm just going to give you the verses because we got to go quick. I'm done as soon as I get this done. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 34 says, awake to righteousness. You see it in light of the new covenant? Wake up to your right standing in God. That's good. See, we've been lulled to sleep. Did anybody catch that? We've been L-A-W-E-D'd to sleep. Hear that? Love not sleep, lest thou come to poverty. In other words, you don't appropriate what you already have in Christ. Open thine eyes. I love that. Jesus would say stuff like, he that has ears to hear, let him hear. The hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord has made both of them, it says in another place in Proverbs. Open thy eyes and thou shalt be satisfied with bread. John chapter 6, 41, 48, 51, around all three of those verses, Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Love not sleep. Don't sleep to who you are in Christ. Awake to righteousness and sin not, it goes on to say, by the way. It's not sin not and you'll be righteous. Awake to who you are. And the result of that is, I don't want to do that. That's not who I am. You know what? I want to go to church. That is who I am. I want to hear Jesus. I know it. Bless God, you are the church. I call it semantic psychoness. I remember back in the day, you know, speaking the word, Kelly, take care. No, don't take care. Don't take care. Watch what you say. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Don't take care. I'm not saying take anxiety. I'm just saying take care of yourself. Be good to yourself. Oh, I could slap some people. I mean, it gets ridiculous. I call it semantic psychoticness. It's crazy. That's not, I mean, come on, man. It's like, don't take care, brother. And then you walk around and you come up to people and I'm sitting there like planning how do I need to say this? I am not. I better be careful because if I say it this way, then I'll get corrected here. And I'll get, love not sleep, lest thou come to poverty. Open thine eyes, and thou shalt be satisfied with the bread of life, and his name is Jesus. Open your eyes, awake to righteousness, and that's the power to sin not. He did not just get you out of trouble, but he got you into a life. Deuteronomy 6:23 says he brought you out to bring you in. That's a picture of the new covenant. But see, some people just got the out part right. Instead of realizing, man, he didn't just get me out, he got me in. Look who I am. That's what we say. You're a master. Once again, I'm going to close with this. Somebody's acting whatever. Remind them who they are. You're a master. You don't have to fly off the handle when somebody says something to you. You're in charge because of who you are in Christ. That's how you handle it. But if you tell them, you just need to straighten up. I'm talking to believers now. Then people are trying to straighten up, and they're, how's that working for us? Amen. Are you blessed? Amen. Praise the Lord. Join hands. Let's just pray. Well, I didn't get to share that, so I'm just looking at all the stuff I didn't get to go to. It's the Lord, though. Amen. I trust Him to share the right things. Father, I thank You that we are blessed. Everybody said amen. Just right now, I want to just encourage you. Just speak blessing over the person next to you. Just tell them. It doesn't have to be fancy. Just say, you are blessed because of what Jesus has done. You're saved. You're sanctified. You're set apart. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are who He says you are because of who He is in you, who you're in because of what He's done. And everyone said, amen. If there's anybody here, you've never been born again, see me after service. Now, I want to encourage you, fellowship. Hug each other. I know some people, if you got to go, if that turkey's burning, run. No, I'm kidding. But I'm saying that because people, you know, let me tell you this about relationships. I think Curtis said this, and it's mine now, Curtis. But now listen to me. Relationships do take effort, and they do take time. Roger Legg, when they started coming over here, we try to go every month and meet them guys, and they meet us. They take effort. They take time, but they're worth it. Because when you're around, you know who I met this weekend? Mark Sanchez. Not the quarterback for the Jets, but that is his name. He's a pastor. So we joke about it. He says he's seen Bill Belichick, the quarterback of he's a preacher. It's so funny. He's seen Bill Belichick, the quarterback or the head coach of the New England Patriots. He said he's seen him in a lobby where they were having a meeting. And he goes, run in there. And he goes, Bill Belichick, Mark Sanchez. And Belichick goes, get up. He thought he was a Fruit Loop. Most of my friends are loopy. I'm kidding. You guys are loved, amen? Hallelujah. Have a great day.